During that time, I believe God gave me a picture. And the picture was one of some huge gates that were very firmly shut. And these gates were holding behind them a huge, what looked like a huge wall of swirling water. Huge, huge gates, firmly closed, and behind them, a big load of water moving and ready to go. But last Sunday evening, I shared something of that with Envisioned. And what prompted me to share it was that in the time of sharing, after we'd prayed and spent some time seeking God, one of our members said, quite simply, again, all I've got is the word floodgates. Now, I hadn't said about this picture at all, but you can understand why I then shared it. Still no wiser of what it meant, but the fact that someone else was indicating that God was saying something of that nature, I wanted to pursue it. Floodgates. And I said to the group, I said, why is it that the gates are closed? I don't understand. And then the answer came. Ismat understood and said, the reason the gates are closed is because God will open them in his timing. At the moment, what he is doing is pouring himself into us.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Opening God's Floodgates by Liz Robertson.
Well, what a time to be part of Greenford Baptist Church. What a time. I've been a part of this church since I was six. So that's over 20 years. And the rest, yes. And I have never known a time like this. Never known a time of God's blessing, of God's acceleration. Some of you may know that I'm part of a group, Envisioned. Are people who are interested in and want to know more about and move in the prophetic. And we meet once a month on a Sunday evening, and it's open to anybody to come along. And last Sunday evening was a remarkable evening when we met together. And there was an agreement that at this stage in Greenford Baptist Church life, God is going up a gear. He's been going up gears, if you can imagine driving a car, over a period of time now. It would be hard to specify how long. It's a number of years. And the gears keep going up, and the pace keeps increasing, and there are more blessings, and there is more release of God's Spirit and activity in a way that I don't think any of us have seen previously. And that's encouraging, yes? And it's scary, yes? Because what's it leading to? God is an intentional God. He does nothing by chance. It is leading to something. Now, I don't preach very often. You'd have to ask David why that was. That's fine by me. And a while ago, I came across an old notebook where I had written some notes down, and I cannot remember where I was and who was speaking, but I want to make that clear that this is not me. I am repeating something that somebody else has said at some stage. And when I found this notebook and I read the notes, and I thought, wow, yeah, that is for Greenford. That's good stuff. That needs to be said. But do you know what? The last time I looked at it when I was about to preach, it wasn't relevant. There wasn't that kind of amen when I read it in the spirit. So I had to think of something else to say. But this time, it feels right. It's something of a number of things I want to share with us this morning. And if there's time, after I've spoken, to give opportunity, if you feel that God has spoken to you and you want to respond, to allow people to do that also as well. I want to give a bit of history, first of all. Years and years and years ago, when I first was wondering what it was that God was gifting me in, David called me one side and asked me that very question. And I thought, I don't know, quick, make something up. Healing? And he graciously said, well, maybe. But he said, when I was thinking and praying about it, I thought maybe you saw pictures and heard from God in that way. And I thought, yeah, actually, you're right. How did you know that? I do see pictures. And I hadn't made the connection between the two. I just thought that was how I was. It turns out that's what God had given me when I was praying initially. So David said, well, let's see what God has to say about that. Let's see if he will confirm that. Ask him the next time you're in a church meeting to do that, to release that gift of pictures, and in a way, by doing that, confirm that that's what he's calling you to do and into. So I did. And that next meeting was an evening meeting here. I'm going back a long, long time. And before the meeting started, we'd been praying. And I had this picture of a huge, huge wave. A huge wave coming and crashing down on the shore. Massive wave. So I sat in the congregation. And the guy came out. And he said, he was a visiting speaker. And he said, I'm here to say to you tonight that there is a big wave of God's Spirit about to hit this country. Whoa, I think I saw that. Many years later, I was at a conference. I was relating this story the other evening to the team. I was at a conference and we were singing a worship song that was new to all of us at this conference. And it was about letting the rain come down, something like that. And it was a very powerful song. Very powerful. Powerful in the way that it kind of touched the heart of God. Do you know that kind of song? And we were all, yes, yes, we want that rain to come down. And someone challenged me after that time of worship. And they said, do you know what? I think I heard God ask me a question during that. Do you really want it to rain? Because when it rains, it gets messy and muddy and dirty and untidy. Do you really want it to rain? Do you know what you're asking for? Because usually you're happiest when it's sunny and dry. Whoa, and that really challenged me. We sing these songs and we say, do this, do that, let this happen, show your power. Do we really know what we're asking him to do? And in that, taking up responsibility. So I had to do some serious thinking, and I didn't go to the next session at this conference. I walked around the campsite saying to God, I know I should say yes. But that's a hard thing to say when you're right. It gets messy and muddy and complicated and not easy. At the end of that half an hour, I concluded I had no choice but to say yes, but to acknowledge what I was doing in saying yes. It was not an easy thing. The very next seminar session I walked into after that was a tricky one too. It was about gifts of the Spirit. And the woman taking it, Christine Noble, she just basically said, right, this half of the room, stand up, find someone on that half of the room and give them a word from God. Oh, you're supposed to be teaching us. Good way of teaching. Then, of course, reciprocate this half to that half. And a person came and stood behind me, put their hands on my shoulders, didn't say anything for a while, and then said, I see a cloud over your head and it's raining. She said that. And then she said, I'm not going to say anything else. I said, you don't need to. God is doing something. He is laying the groundwork for something. It's not going to happen tomorrow. Well, it might do, but this is over a long period of time, okay? Kind of like the Israelites going through the desert. Where is this promised land? And you can get discouraged, as they do. And we read about them going off and doing their own thing, don't we? Because it's not happening as quickly or in a way as they'd like it to. So in a way, they're saying, yes, we believe what God is saying, and yes, we want to see it. But on the other hand, we want it under our terms, in our timing. And yes, I found myself thinking, did I imagine that? Have I made this up? Nothing seems to be changing that radically. Maybe it is just make-believe. Well, week before last, when we had the guys that came and talked to us about the healing on the streets of Greenford, during that time, I believe God gave me a picture. And the picture was one of some huge gates that were very firmly shut. And these gates were holding behind them a huge, what looked like a huge wall of swirling water. Huge, huge gates, firmly closed, and behind them a big load of water moving and ready to go. And straight away I thought, oh, is this about me? As we usually do. Is it me? Is it lack of faith that's holding these gates closed and the water wants to come out but it can't because I don't believe strongly enough? What is it? And I chatted to the guy afterwards and I don't think we came to any conclusions. But last Sunday evening I shared something of that with Envisioned. And what prompted me to share it was that in the time of sharing after we'd prayed and spent some time seeking God, one of our members said, quite simply, again, all I've got is the word floodgates. Now, I hadn't said about this picture at all, but you can understand why I then shared it. Still no wiser of what it meant, but the fact that someone else was indicating that God was saying something of that nature, I wanted to pursue it. Floodgates. And I said to the group, I said, why is it that the gates are closed? I don't understand. And then the answer came. Ismat understood and said, the reason the gates are closed is because God will open them in his timing. At the moment, what he is doing is pouring himself into us. Pouring himself in. And at the right time, the gates will open. Now, has anyone ever seen floodgates open? It is not a trickle. It's not even a stream or a river. It's a one almighty release of power. But they're not open yet. Turn to Ezekiel 43. I'm not a biblical scholar, so what I know from the internet. But Ezekiel is being shown a vision of the new temple. And we know from what we've heard about Exodus, from David teaching in Exodus, that God wanted to dwell with his people. That was the key thing. And the temple was the place where he would be with his people. And in the previous chapter, a man has taken Ezekiel round, very carefully measuring out in precise detail the dimensions of the building. I want to pick it up in the beginning of chapter 43. After this, the man brought me back around to the east gateway. Suddenly, the glory of the Lord of Israel appeared from the east. The sound of his coming was like a roar of rushing waters. Interesting. And the whole landscape shone with his glory. This vision was just like the others I had seen, first by the Kabar River and then when he came to destroy Jerusalem. I fell face down on the ground, and the glory of the Lord came into the temple through the east gateway. Then the Spirit took me up and brought me into the inner courtyard, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And I heard someone speaking to me from within the temple, while the man who had been measuring stood beside me. The Lord said to me, "Son of man, this is the place of my throne, and the place where I will rest my feet. I will live here forever among the people of Israel. They and their kings will not defile my holy name any longer by their adulterous worship of other gods or by honouring the relics of their kings who have died. They put their idolaters right next to mine with only a wall between them and me. They defiled my holy name by such detestable sin, so I consumed them in my anger. Now, stop worshipping other gods and honouring the relics of their kings, and I will live among them forever." If we want all that God has for us, we need to be right with him. We can't be double-minded. The prophecy that came to the church in 98 mentioned having clean lives. We can't be one thing in one room and something different in another. These people worshipped God in one room, and in the room next door, they worshipped idols and did things that had no place in their relationship with God. And I think God would challenge us this morning. What we do in one room, what we do in the other room, there cannot be that division. God wants to dwell among us. We are holy people. As Carlene so brilliantly put it this morning, all our sin is dealt with. There is an answer. We acknowledge, ask for forgiveness, and it is dealt with. It is done. It is wiped out. Mother's Day, and I'm a mother, and it's the best thing ever you can do. It is also the hardest thing that you can do. And disciplining your child is a hard thing to do. I'm really grateful to God that he's used many, many occasions where I can understand a little bit more about his relationship with me because I have that relationship with my daughter. I think I needed a bit of help, and he gave it to me. I mentioned revelation at the beginning about asking God in this morning. Just before he says, "Look, I stand at the door and knock," he says something else to the church at Laodicea. He says, "I correct and discipline everyone I love." And that's what a mother does. I correct and discipline, to the best of my ability, Sophie, because I want the best for her. I don't want her spoilt and ruined. And God doesn't want that for us either. He's never disappointed. That old cliche, he's never disillusioned, because he had no illusions in the first place about us. He knew what we were when he chose to take us on, and he wants to continue taking us on. We make it difficult for ourselves in hiding away and thinking, "Oh no, I can't be like that. I'm too sinful." Look what Simon Peter said in Luke 5. Jesus was getting known, and people wanted to hear him, and they'd do anything, even push him into the water. So he was like, you know, on the edge of the shore. He looks back, there's a boat. "I'll get into the boat. I'll speak to the people from the boat." And when he'd finished speaking, chapter 5, verse 5, sorry, verse 4. He finished speaking. He said to Simon, the fisherman whose boat it was, "Now go out into that where it's deeper, let down your nets and catch some fish." "Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a thing. But if you say so, I'll let down the nets again." And this time their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "Oh Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you." And we can be like that sometimes when we know we've got issues. We know God's maybe putting his finger on something and saying, "Stop that now. That was okay for now, but now I'm looking for a deeper degree of holiness, a deeper degree of commitment. I want clean lives for this next move of my spirit." Leave that old way behind. Oh, go away. I'm too much of a sinner. Get away from me. Remember, he corrects and disciplines everyone he loves. And he doesn't just do it by saying, "That thing there, that's wrong. That thing there, stop." He does more than that, because he is a redeemer. He doesn't just want to take something away. He wants to replace it, and not replace it with something of the same size. Something that's going to be of great benefit to us and to the people around us. I'll show you what I'm trying to explain. If you looked at Ephesians 4. Looking at verse 21. "Since you have heard about Jesus and learnt the truth that came from him, throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. Stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbours the truth, for we are all part of the same body. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry, for anger gives a foothold to the devil. If you are a thief, quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for good hard work, and then give generously to others in need. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. And don't bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit in the way you live. Remember, he has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words and slander, as well as all types of evil behaviour. Instead, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. A whole set of things that he wanted to address in people. If you're a thief, quit stealing. We can be thieves in many, many ways. There are many things that we can be stealing. Quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for good and help people who need help. So it's not just a stop that, it's a and then do this. It's redeeming what you're doing. Don't use foul and abusive language. Instead, let everything you say be a blessing and an encouragement. I think when this force of water is released, it's going to be a redemptive force of water. It's going to bring wholeness and healing. Can you get my bag? My bag. Thanks. I think, when you think of Noah's flood, that was kind of total wiping out. This flood is going to be different. This is going to bring restoration and wholeness. Rangina, are you here? Do you remember what you emailed me?
God has been sending his rain upon us for the last few years, cleansing and preparing us for the overflowing of his Spirit and anointing. The dam's ready to burst, and the floodgates will be opened with healing waters for the body, soul, and mind, and we will see him proclaimed throughout, and all the people of him will see his glory.
If you think God is speaking to you this morning, maybe your initial reaction is like Simon Peter, wanting to back away. Can I encourage you not to this morning? God wants to dwell with his people. Our motto for this year is that we are being built together as living stones, a place where God will inhabit, a place where God will come and his glory will be seen. We need to be ready for that. We need to be carriers of that. He wants the best for us. Like a parent correcting a child. Let me encourage you this morning to take this opportunity to respond. In a few minutes, I'm going to play a piece of music. And while that music is playing, I want to invite you to do whatever feels appropriate in response to God this morning. It may be that you'll need to come to the front here and make a physical response in your posturing, to stand, to kneel, to lie. You may rather do something else. Ask the person next to you, ask one of the leaders to pray with and for you. The Lord said to me, Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place where I will rest my feet. I will live here forever among the people of Israel. Old habits die hard. That phrase has been ringing in my head all morning. Old habits die hard. If we want to see the glory of God touch us and others, we need maybe to let go of some old habits. We need to be prepared to let God examine us, challenge us, and redeem the areas of our life that we haven't yet given over to him. We need to be set apart for him. He's looking for holy people to come and dwell among. He wants clean lives. He has so much. He is doing so much. And will want to do so much more. Don't let pride, don't let arrogance, don't let fear get in the way of God blessing the community around us and beyond. I truly believe that, this country. We have a part to play. If you sang those songs this morning, you have a responsibility before God to honour what you've asked him to play your part in that too. This is serious stuff. If you need to make a response, now is the time to do it.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.